So, as tradition, every time when the league officially announced the regular season schedule, I, of course, would immediately do a video the very next day talking about the Quakes' full 34 game season. And that, of course, is what I'm going to do today, as we're going to look at all 34 of these games. And that, as I mentioned yesterday, talking about when the regular season was released, despite the fact that I was hoping maybe this year, not only the season is going to be back to 34 games, but I'm hoping maybe there's going to be more interconference matchup in it. There isn't going to be as much of a regional matchup as we saw last year in that shortened season. And unfortunately, that doesn't seem like it's going to be the case, because 32 of the 34 team that the Quakes are going to be playing this year is going to be a Western Conference opponent. The Quakes are going to at least play two time against these Western Conference opponent, and there's even some teams that is based in the region that the Quakes are playing and are actually going to be playing free time this year. And those teams are the two LA team, the two Cascadia team, and also the Vancouver Whitecaps. And I think RSL was also another team that we play free time this year. And I think we also play two of the Free Texas team, including the new boys, Austin FC, free time this season. And that the two Eastern Conference team that we are going to play this season is going to be DC United and Orlando City. And I think we play both of these teams near the first half of the season, with DC United being at home and Orlando City, that game is going to be on the road. But let us actually get to this schedule. And oh, by the way, there's going to be eight games this season that the Quakes are going to be on national television. There's going to be six that is going to be on Univision / Unimas, and also Twitter. And although it's definitely not as much as what we saw in 2019, where there was like nine games in the Quakes regular season that was broadcast on Twitter and on Unimas. And you probably already heard me talk about how much I hate watching game on Twitter, and especially how watching Quakes game on Twitter's, because literally 50% of the time all they just talk about is Almeida, and then the other 25% of the time they just talk about random gibberish, and they only spent like 5% of the time actually commentating the game. And well, this year they're only going to cover Quakes games only six times this season. That is still way too much of my liking of seeing the Quakes that is going to be on Univision and Unimas. But what can you do? I mean, this is what happened when you have Almeida as the head coach, and also a bunch of these Liga MX these opponent, because Univision, when they see Almeida and also see all these kind of Chivas player, they know that they have to choose us as a team to basically broadcast some of these games, because that is where exactly the ratings is going to happen. Now, as I said, let us actually begin in terms of the first game of the season, which I already mentioned before when they announced the season home opener. In fact, there's the first two game and also the game in June against Austin FC, I've already mentioned 2 weeks ago. But just for you to give you a little bit of a refresh, the first game of the season is going to be against the Houston Dynamo on the road at 5 p.m. Pacific. And only the fact that that's the first game of the season for the Quakes, that is actually the first game of the season in general in MLS. And I think this is the first time ever that the Quakes are playing actually the first in an MLS schedule. And it's kind of also weird, the fact that, this game, even though this is the first game of the season, it's not nationally televised, and it's just going to be on a regional broadcast. But the very next game is the home opener against FC Dallas, and that one is going to be the first of six games that's going to be either on Twitter, Univision, or Unimas, that is going to be taking place at 12:30 p.m. Pacific. I have heard about how the Quakes are going to distribute tickets for that season opener, and it looks like season ticket holder is going to get the priority, which is good news for me because I am a season ticket holder. But it will be also be very interesting to see how are they going to distribute, because right now they only allow 20% capacity. And I know the county here in Bay Area, some of them have already gone to the orange tier, which can increase the capacity to 33%. But I believe Santa Clara County is still in the red zone, and if it stays in the red zone during the day that when the Quakes are going to be having their home opener, then it will be 20% capacity. capacity, but hopefully that might not be the case. Maybe Santa Clara County eventually will move to that orange zone and we will have 33% capacity during that game. Now, the very next one, they of course will be playing against DC United, which is one of the two Eastern Conference teams that we're going to face this regular season, and this is a home game at 7 p.m. Pacific time. I guess the reason why the league decided to choose DC United as one of the Eastern Conference team we face is because they kind of want to make up for what happened last year, where last year they were going to have the Quakes play DC United in a national televised game in celebration of the 25th anniversary of the first ever game in league history. But unfortunately, that did not happen because of this thing called the COVID pandemic kind of ruined that plan. So they basically decided to kind of make it up for this. Although this time it's not going to be a national televised game, and that it's just going to be on a regional network. So yeah, that's kind of interesting that they did not make that national televised, and I'm assuming there's probably going to be some throwback that is going to happen in this game, because anytime when the Quakes play against DC United, I know the Quakes usually kind of have some throwback theme because of the fact that this is not only the first opponent that the Quakes have ever played in their MLS history, but also the first ever game in league history. Now, the very, very next game, which is going to be a couple of days later, they're going to be playing against RSL on the road. That's going to be at 6:30 p.m. Pacific time. Then, a couple of days later, we have our first midweek games, which is going to be at home against the Seattle Sounders, followed by another home game to play against the other Cascadia team, that is the Portland Timbers, at 7 p.m. Pacific. Before, just a couple of days later, and actually 7 days later, the Quakes will be playing against Sporting KC at 7 p.m. Pacific. So the Quakes has a very heavy home schedule to start the season. I believe their first seven game of the season, five of them is actually at home. And some of these opponents that the Quakes are playing against at home are kind of winnable game. Although this home stretch where the Quakes are going to be playing Seattle, Portland, and Sporting KC, that is definitely going to be a tough home stretch, because you know those are a team that you would assume that this season they're going to be definitely a playoff team, and that they might be even finish in the top half of the Western Conference. So it'll be interesting to see how the Quakes will do in those games, and also it'll be interesting to see whether or not if the Quakes can get off to a good start, because from what we saw in the last 2 years under Almeida, getting a good start to the season has been a huge issue for the Quakes. I mean, you know, last year they kind of got to a good start if you actually count the MLS is back tournament during the group stage, but the first two games was an absolute disaster where, you know, they drew 2-2 against TFC in a game that they were very fortunate to drew. And then of course the Blues not derby against Minnesota, they lost 5-2 in that one before the pause. And if the pause didn't happen, I can tell you that the Quakes were probably going to be on a really bad losing streak, and in some way the pause really helped the fact that the Quakes of course was able to regroup in the MLS's back tournament. But even looking after the MLS's back tournament, the Quakes immediately went on that horrid stretch in phase one of the MLS schedule, and they only really started to pick it up during the middle part of the season. Well, when you look at the schedule, and as I will talk about the middle part of the schedule, there is some very tough games in the middle of the schedule. In fact, this game against Sporting KC that the Quakes are going to be playing at home, this is actually the last game that is going to be taking place at Quake Stadium until July 24th. Against the Houston Dynamo, because after that they are going to be embarking a stretch where they're going to have 10 games where they are going to be playing on the road 8 times that during those 10 game stretch, and only be playing 2 home games, which one of them is going to be taking place at Stamford Stadium against the LA Galaxy. But yeah, they have a very heavy road stretch after the Sporting KC game, and it all starts when they play against the Galaxy on May 29th on the road on Saturday. This game also is going to be on national television and on Twitter at 5 p.m. Pacific. And then just a couple of weeks after, we have kind of a Euros break on June 19th is the game where the Quakes are going to be playing against Austin and will become the first team to be going to Austin New Stadium and facing against them. I think this is the first time the Quakes have been able to play against an opponent that is basically having their grand opening of their home stadium. So I can't wait to see how this matchup is going to be, and that this is also going to be another matchup that's going to be on national television, and it's going to be on Unimas again at 6 p.m. Pacific time, 8 p.m. local time. Then just a couple of days later, the Quakes would be flying to the East Coast for the only time this season, as they're going to be going to Orlando City to play against them in a midweek game. I'm assuming most likely what this will do is that when the Quakes do play against Austin, I'm assuming they're probably not going to be flying back to San Jose, and they'll probably just maybe stay somewhere around the middle part of the country and then fly their way to the East Coast. I mean, I know there's been times where in other sports, and especially in football, where sometimes when a team do have like a back-to-back East Coast kind of away trip, or if there's like a game that is in the Midwest and then there's another on the East Coast the following week, they usually stay somewhere where in the Midwest or somewhere near in the East Coast, so that they don't have to like fly back to their city and then also fly all the way across the country again. So it'll be very interesting to see whether or not if the Quakes are going to do that, where after that game against Austin, they're not going to fly back to San Jose and just going to be staying somewhere in the Midwest or even in the East Coast. Then the following week, they will fly back to home, but they won't be playing at home in this game, as this game on June 26th on Saturday is the annual tradition of the Cali Clásico at Stanford Stadium, which will be taking place on Unimas at 7 p.m. Pacific. I was kind of surprised that they were thinking about having the Cali Clásico at Stanford because of this whole pandemic situation. But I guess maybe they're hoping by the time when the Cali Clásico at Stanford is going to happen, they will hope that maybe they will allow full capacity or maybe even 50% capacity in the stadium. And also because Stanford Stadium is much bigger than the Quake Stadium, you know, that game, even if it's going to be limited capacity or maybe like 50% capacity, they can still allow about 20,000 fans or 25,000 fans in that stadium, which is by far much more than if it's going to be a full capacity crowd at the Quake Stadium. But after that, they go back on the road, and they of course would be playing in the first of two Blues Knot Derby against Minnesota United at 5 p.m. Pacific time. Before on my birthday, they are going to be playing against the Colorado Rapids away at 6 p.m. Pacific. Then 2 weeks later, and I believe this is during when the Gold Cup is happening, so that's why there's like a 2 week gap, they would be playing in a midweek game. Or actually, no, I'm sorry. The Rapids against the Quakes, that's actually not July 7th. It's actually July 17th. I actually didn't know that this was actually a 17 instead of a 7. So during this game between Minnesota and the next one against Colorado, this is when the Gold Cup break is going to happen. But when the Quakes does come back from the Gold Cup break, their first game is going to be against the Colorado Rapids, followed by the very next game where they stay on the road playing against Sporting KC. Again, this is another type of scenario where I wonder whether or not if the Quakes are going to just stay somewhere in the Midwest and don't fly back to San Jose because they have another game in a very short amount of period where they need to of course go on the road again, and this time it's going to be against Sporting KC, which will kick off at 5:30 p.m. Pacific, 7:30 p.m. local time. Then 3 days later, they will go back home for the first time since May, where they're going to be playing against the Houston Dynamo at 7 p.m. Pacific. And then just a week later, they will be playing against the Seattle Sounders on the road. This is actually a Sunday game, and it's actually not only a national televised game, but it's also going to be on FS1. And I think this is also the only game where there's actually not a time set when exactly this game is going to take place. And, you know, although I'm happy the Quakes, at least if when they are on national television and that it's not on Unimas or even on Twitter, I'm definitely not happy the fact that the Quakes are going to be playing one of the few games that it's going to be on FS1 or on ESPN, and they're going to be playing against the Seattle Sounders, because, you know, the last time when the Quakes visit the Sounders, in fact, the last two times when the Quakes visit the Seattle Sounder, they got outscored 11-2 during that stretch. So I am really concerned that not only the fact that this is a national televised game, but yeah, something tells me there's going to be a national televised embarrassment that the Quakes are going to be suffer against the Seattle Sounders in this game. But you never know. Maybe things will be different, and hopefully maybe by then the Sounders might be struggling a little bit, and maybe the Quakes kind of catch some fire a little bit, although it's going to be tough for them to catch fire when they have so many road games during the stretch between May to July, because you know the Quakes, they usually never do well on the road. And even though there are some of these road games that is winnable, I'm not banking the fact that this Quakes team is going to win probably more than three games during this stretch where they have to go on the road 8 times in 10 games. Now, following that game against the Seattle Sounders, they have another short break and have a midweek game, this time playing against the other Cascadia team, the Portland Timbers, at 7:30 p.m. Pacific, followed by another short week and a weekend game, and they're actually going to be heading back home to play against LAFC at 4 p.m. Pacific. I'm kind of surprised this game is not on national television, because usually when games that is taking place on Sunday, it's usually on national television, and especially the time that this game is kicking off at 4 o'clock. I would assume this game is on national television, and especially it's the Quakes versus LAFC, which I see a couple of times they did put this game on national television. Yeah, I'm kind of surprised the fact that they decide not to do so. Maybe they'll find a way to kind of like if both of these teams are kind of competitive, they might flex the schedule a little bit and maybe put that game on FS1 or on ESPN, or even hopefully not on Unimas and Twitter in that game between the Quakes and LAFC. Oh, also, by the way, starting this game when the Quakes play against Houston, this also start a stretch where after that brutal road run where they have 8 out of their 10 games that is going to be on the road, this is when the brutal road stretch kind of start to come to an end, and the Quakes are going to get a bunch of home games that's going to be happening in late July and August, which is kind of something that has happened before with the Quakes. I remember back in 2017, 2016, and 2015 season, we tends to have a lot of home game in August, and it seemed like it's going to be the case once again. In fact, that Quakes versus LAFC game actually kick off a free game home stretch, where the very next one we're going to be playing against the Vancouver Whitecaps in the Third Wheel Derby. That game is actually going to be on Friday at 7:30 p.m. Pacific. Again, you know, Friday games, sometimes they usually are on national televised, and the fact that they decide not to televise the Third Wheel Derby, yeah, I feel like, I keep telling people, the Third Wheel Derby is one of the most underrated derby in the league, and I don't care if you don't think that this is a real derby and it's just a silly name, I enjoyed it. Like, I always enjoy playing against the Vancouver Whitecaps, and even though I don't hate the Vancouver Whitecaps, it's just great to see the Quakes play against them in this Third Wheel Derby, and we tends to have like a banter, the fact that we're always the team that kind of get left out in our region. And also, I think this might be the first time in a couple of seasons where we are not playing the Vancouver Whitecaps on Rivalry Week, because as I'm gonna mention a little bit later, actually mentioning now, after the game when the Quakes are going to be playing against Minnesota in the second edition of the Blues Knot Derby in a midweek game at 7:30 p.m. Pacific, that's when we're going to have our Heineken Rivalry Week game, and we're actually going to be playing against the Galaxy on the road, and it's actually going to be national televised on ESPN. I mean, I think this is the first time in a couple years, probably since 2017, when the Cali Classico was actually broadcast on ESPN or FS1. I mean, I know it's been broadcast on Unimas a couple of times, but it hasn't been broadcast on the big network, and I know some people will say that the Cali Classico has started to kind of died out a little bit because of the El Tráfico rivalry between the Galaxy and LAFC, but it's great that at least the league acknowledged the fact that that rivalry might not be dead yet, and we're actually going to be featuring that game on one of our Heineken Rivalry Week. So yeah, that game, of course, is going to be taking place on Friday against the Galaxy at 7 p.m. Pacific. Then a couple of days later, or actually not a couple of days later, just two weeks later, because this is actually during the time when the league is actually going to have two Heineken Rivalry Week, and that there's going to be some teams that's going to be playing in the first week of Heineken Rivalry Week, and then there's going to be some team that's playing on the second week of the Heineken Rivalry Week. But then after that, in September 4th, the Quakes will be playing against the Colorado Rapids. This game is also going to be on Unimas at 7 p.m. Pacific. And I believe this game is also going to be taking place during the international break, which I'm definitely not happy. The fact that a game is taking place during an international break. In fact, I don't think anybody is happy to see their team play on international break. And I mentioned how MLS is one of those weird league that, for whatever reason, even during the international break, they still have club games that is taking place. And a lot of teams have always complained that of course is the case, because during those games they might not have a full squad because of the fact that a lot of those players are currently on international duty. Now the very next week we are going to be going on the road against FC Dallas at 5:30 p.m. Pacific, 7:30 p.m. local time. Before, we got another midweek game this time against RSL at home. That's going to be taking place at 7:30 p.m. Pacific. I think the back end of the home schedule for the Quakes, they have a lot of midweek games that is going to be taking place. And I'm definitely not happy the fact that a lot of these home games at the back end of the schedule is going to be taking place in the middle of the week, because, you know, at this point, we probably might get to a point where maybe things are going to return to normal and there is going to be full capacity. And while I was hoping maybe we can get a huge, a large fan or a full capacity at the Quake Stadium during the playoff run, that's not going to help when you have so many of these games in the back end of the schedule that's going to be taking place in the middle of the week. And as I said before, midweek games are usually ones that is very tough on in terms of attendance-wise, and a lot of team always tends to struggle during midweek games. So I don't know why exactly the league decided to schedule us with so many midweek games at home at the back end of the schedule, but one of them is going to be against RSL. That's going to be taking place at 7:30 p.m. Pacific. After that, they are going to be playing on Saturday, and they're going to once again going to Austin to play against them at 6 p.m. Pacific time. Before the very next week, they return to Quake Stadium and return at home to play against LAFC at 7 p.m. Pacific. And then there's another midweek game, this time against the Seattle Sounders at 7:30 p.m. Pacific, before just a couple of days later they fly up north. And hopefully by then, you know, the Canadian government would allow Canadian team to play in their home market, and the Whitecaps can of course play their home game at BC Place instead of at Rio Tinto Stadium that they're currently calling themselves a home temporarily. But yeah, they're going to be playing against the Whitecaps in that game at 7 p.m. Pacific time before just 2 weeks later, because we do have an international break in October, and I'm glad the Quakes are actually not playing on an international break during October. But yeah, after the international break, they are going to be playing against LAFC, and I believe this is the last game that is going to be on Univision and on Twitter. It's also going to be a lunchtime kickoff game at 12 p.m. Pacific time. Now, after that, they have another short week. This time, they're going to be returning home and playing against the new boys, Austin FC, and the only time they're going to be playing against Austin FC at home at 7:30 p.m. Pacific, before they have another home game, this time against the Vancouver Whitecaps at 7 p.m. Pacific, before they go on the road to Portland, and they're going to be playing against them on Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific. Then they go on the road again, and I actually got this wrong here. It's actually RSL versus San Jose Earthquakes, not San Jose Earthquakes versus RSL. I usually put the home team on the left and the road team on the right. But yeah, they're going to be going on the road during that game at 6:30 p.m. Pacific. And then they finish the season on Decision Day, where they're going to be playing against Dallas on Decision Day, which, you know, what's interesting about that game is, and also I got the time of that game wrong, it's not a 7 p.m. kickoff, it's actually a 3 p.m. kickoff on Sunday. But what's interesting about that game is that we start the season in our home opener against Dallas, and we finish the last home game of the regular season against Dallas. It's almost like there's a circle of life that has gone on with the Quakes schedule this season, where the team we face at home first is the team that we're going to be playing last in the regular season at home. And also looking at the schedule, or at least the last couple of games of the schedule, yeah, I think think this might be the first time in a couple of seasons where I don't have to complain about how the back end of the schedule is incredibly hard and that the Quakes have a murderous row in terms of their playoff push. I mean, sure, yeah, they do have a bit of a tough game against the Portland Timbers on the road, which that probably is going to be an automatic loss because whenever the Quakes play against Portland, it's usually an automatic loss for them. And then they, of course, also have that LAFC game, which is going to be tough for them. But you know, when you look at the last five games, there are a lot of those games, and at least four of those five games that I see in the last five game of the season are winnable bowl games. So you know, for once, the Quakes don't actually have a tough schedule to end the season, which, you know, time will tell whether or not if that's going to help them. But with the way that when they get to that back end of the schedule, are they actually going to be in a playoff push? And I won't be surprised in this game against Dallas on decision day, there could be a situation where this game could be national televised because, you know, coming into this season, and especially I just listened to Extra Time Radio and they just mentioned how this season they're going back to the regular their season, or they're going back to the old playoff format. Well, it's not really the old playoff format, but the 2019 playoff format where 17 from each conference make it to the playoffs. You know, this when you look at all these teams in the Western Conference, I think the Quakes and Dallas are going to be those teams that's kind of almost right around the bubble in terms of making the playoffs. Dallas for the past couple of years has been always been right there near the bubble in terms of making the playoffs. So don't be surprised if this game could potentially be a game in the future where this could really decide who, of course, would make it to the playoffs and who, of course, would be out of the playoffs. And if that is the case, then yeah, you know, I'm definitely excited the fact that this is going to be on national television. And the last time when the Quakes did had a do or die situation where they have to win to make it to the playoffs, it was against the Portland Timbers in 2019, but unfortunately we lost that one because it was on the road. And that, as I mentioned, anytime when the Quakes play on the road against the Timbers at Providence Park, it's usually an automatic loss. But this time at least we get to play at home against Dallas, a team that we do have a really good record against in the past couple of seasons. But yeah, there you have it. That is pretty much it. The schedule for the Quakes this season. And again, you know, when I look at the schedule, yes, it is definitely, there are going to be some tough stretches. And you know, this stretch during the middle part of the season is going to be really brutal. And I won't be surprised if the Quakes are going to really start to fall off a little bit in the middle part of the season, which is also why I've just mentioned earlier, it is so important this season that the Quakes need to get off to a good start because of how brutal that middle part of the season is. But at least in the back end of the schedule, it's not going to be as tough as it is, and they do have a good amount of home games to end this season. But again, you know, because this is a region, most of these games are based on regional matchup, and I mentioned last year of how much I do not like regional matchup, not only because the fact that I get tired of facing the Seattle Sounders, the Portland Timbers, LAFC, and the Galaxy like almost every single week, but the fact that those teams I mentioned are teams that probably are going to make the playoffs, and teams some of these teams might even compete for MLS Cup this season. It is definitely not going to be easy in terms of trying to make the playoffs when we have those kind of daunting kind of schedule. But that being said, the Quakes are going to have to make the playoffs again. They need to do what they did last season, which is able to win some of those key games to just sneak into the playoffs. Although, unlike last season, they have to make sure they finish seventh in the Eastern Conference and not in eighth place because, you know, this season, since we're going back to the 2019 playoff format, eighth place does not get you into the playoffs this year. But yeah, let me know in the comments below, what do you think of the schedule? Do you like the schedule? What do you think is part of the schedule where you dislike the most, and what is part of the schedule that you definitely fancy the Quakes to do very well during a period of a stretch? Let me know in the comments below. But yeah, hope you guys enjoy this video. If you do, make sure you guys leave a like, smash the subscribe button, and yeah, I of course will see you guys next time.